I'm at the interface of medicine and chemistry. I went to medical school and didn't like it, found it boring, and then went to graduate school for my doctorate. So I'm interested in energy materials, but more on what happens to those materials when you dispose of them in landfills or throw them away. And so we've been looking at the biomedical applications of these energy materials and also their effects on cells. I think the previous speaker gave a fantastic introduction on why we need energy materials. And so these batteries that you use or fuel cells, they tend to be used and then disposed of. So one of the areas that we are thinking over the last 5 to 10 years is what are the effects of these energy materials? So I'll give you a very brief background. Some of this I will skip simply because many of the speakers have alluded to these needs. So I think we already know about the environment and energy needs. I'll talk a little bit about these experiments and then results and conclusion of future work. And we'll take it from there. We just published a monograph with the Springer Nature that will come out, I believe, end of this month. And you guys are more than free to look at that monograph on biosafety and energy materials. So one of the materials that we are looking at are this highly porous three-dimensional organic metal organic frameworks. And the advantage of these materials is that by changing the ligand, the actual carbon ligand, we could change the bond angle. And when you change the bond angle, then the three-dimensional topography of these materials changes. So you can imagine going from a pyramid to a hexagon, where you can go from 60 degrees, 45 degrees, maybe even 120 degrees. And what we notice is that encapsulation and three-dimensional properties of these materials changes. So the advantage of that is we can have a toolbox, and in this toolbox, we can decide to use different metals. And as you know, metals have different valencies, particularly transition metals. And then we can use different ligands. We can have two different metals. And if you have two different metals, you're essentially making a binuclear catalyst. And so you can coat these ligands with different functional groups, just like the previous speaker gave an example of. And these functionalities will allow you to have a certain degree of hydrophobicity and hydrophilicity. So one of the things that we were interested was putting a strain in this material by making or looking at spirochetes. And so spirochetes are basically a material where the bond angle is 90 degrees. So you could think of this almost like an airplane propeller. You have the shaft, the propeller shaft, and then you've got the blades sticking out at an angle. And then you have this type of strain. And the question is, could we use this strain to distribute charge energy? And the idea is that charge energy is distributed more evenly. And so you don't create a hot spot or an electron sink. You basically have like an ice skating topography in terms of charge distribution. And so we use these kind of spirochetes to do that. So let's have a look at what happens as far as using charge to coordinate with biological cells. So many of the speakers talked about new materials. I think the previous speaker from NRA talked about MOFs. And one of the things that you could do is by making these spirochetes, you can make the inside of this material more hydrophilic or more polar, or you could have certain domains. So the middle one is more like a table, the left one's like a donut, or we can have these more complicated topographies like this hexagon, which looks like a S4 topography. And so the idea is that the cells will only come into these red areas, and you can then do certain type of catalysis. Graphene is a very good structural material. It is hybridized carbon, And so the electrons will move in one dimension. You can make it conducting, and it's got high tensile strength. So graphene is our scaffolding material. Some of the speakers talked about aligning materials. And so we can do carbon within carbon nanotubes. And you can see here the average charge does actually depend on the radius. And so you can make carbon nanotubes within nanotubes to have a particular radius or fix the radius and basically just change the ligands or functionalization of the carbon nanotube with nitrogen or phosphorus. And then what you'll notice is some type of oscillation. And then this oscillation can be used as a sensing probe for whatever you're looking at. Similarly, we can go and make tubes, which are the diameter is wider. Typically, when you think of a tube, you think of as a needle. So the thickness is a lot smaller than the length. And so we can modify these materials. You can see right here, this triangular area here tells us about this carbon-carbon hybridization. And so we can then effectively convert this negative charge into a positive charge. And so now you have a hook. And when you have this domain, the cells will interact preferentially on this side, even though chemically, stoichiometry is roughly the same, but here we put a sink in there. And so you now have a way of getting those cells. All right, so you've seen some of the chemistry. So what we wanted to do, and I think the previous speaker did a great job on talking about hyperthermia. And so what we could do is we can ask one of two different questions, which is when you have these energy materials that are formed as nanofilaments, and a lot of times we talk about fuel cells, people talk about platinum nanoparticles or these type of nanoparticles. Once they get into the environment, into the water table, and animals drink the water, what is their effect on soft tissue? So we wanted to answer this two different ways. The first way is, could we treat cells that are rapidly dividing cells, cancerous cells? And so we use a Chinese Chinese ovary hamster model here. And so I think Dr. Ma's already spoken about magnetic induced hyperthermia. So hyperthermia is where you promote cellular apoptosis through a rapid increase of temperature. And actually, typically, it's not apoptosis, it's more like necrosis. So the cell heats up very quickly, and those cells die. We do this naturally ourselves when we have bacterial infection. We have a high fever. That's an engineering solution to get rid of that pathogen. And one of the side effects you may be aware of is memory loss. So if you have a very, very high fever, a lot of times people actually will have short-term memory loss because you've affected those neurons. But the good news is that you've killed that bacterial virus. That's the engineering design. So here's these ovarian cells. You can see they will start blubbing. And here's kind of a cartoon image of those blubbing. So two ways of thinking about this ovarian cell is, one is what would happen if we introduce nanofilaments without the magnetic field, and then nanoparticles without the magnetic field, and then a magnetic field or some combination. And so we used metal organic frameworks to design a material that has this filamentous topography. And this material is octatopic. What that means is it looks like the letter X with another letter X put on top of it at 45 degrees. So think of two propellers, two airplane propellers that are 45 degrees apart. So you'll see a blade every 1/8 of an inch. If this was a real three-dimensional molecule, this one has eight of those type of propellers. And you can see here that this toxicity killing is roughly similar to the current anti-cancer drug that people use. So if you look at the commercial anti-cancer drugs that they use to kill ovarian cells, they are typically 200 parts per billion dosage given over 30 days. And you can see here, this is at 50%, we're roughly at the same dosage. The advantage here is that you're only killing the cancer cells, you're not getting the side effects. Typically, when you take when you take cancer drugs, you have side effects because you're killing epithelial cells at the same time. And what you notice here is that the filaments and the nanoparticles, they're actually in this ovarian tissue, which is solid tissue, it's a solid tumor, they actually behave very, very similarly. But the mechanism, the mechanical mechanism is different. So the filaments are more mechanical damage, like asbestos. And the nanoparticles, they actually induce a very reactive species that basically promotes cellular death by unzipping the DNA. So the nanoparticles, they come in and they kind of coat these ovarian cells. Just like Peter's talk about those platinum spots, you can see kind of these little dots on this ovarian tissue, and they help to unzip the DNA in those dividing cells, and those cells will then die. Whereas the filaments are more like mechanical damage. They'll introduce some stress here as well, but they are more like putting imaginary needles into this soft tissue, and you do basically some type of necrotic cellular breakdown. And you can see right here, these things are blobbing up. And the good news is that these are basically mechanical features. And so one of the things we've noticed is if you do anti-cancer treatment of people, you notice that the drug that you give is the same drug, but the dosage is different. Some people actually are tolerant to the drug, and we call that resistance. Since this is a mechanical, physical process, it doesn't really depend on genetic factors. So if you have a Chinese hamster that are resistant to, say, doxylium, they will not be resistant to these narrow filaments because we're doing this through a mechanical process. So that's one advantage of using nanomaterials, is that you're not relying on intrinsic biochemical immunity, right? So these MOFs, therefore you can change the bond angle here, right? And therefore change the overall topography. And here in this example, we've shown that these materials are very effective at hard tissue, such as these very difficult to treat ovarian cells. This is without the magnetic hypothermia. And if you do in combination, then you can actually treat the cells a little bit easier. So you use the filaments first and then the magnetic field, and you'll notice that the cell tumor dies a little bit quicker than just either or approach. We then went in to look at E. coli. So what actually happened about 8 years ago, there was a mass poisoning in Germany, I believe, where people were eating meat that had E. coli, and that particular version of E. coli was immune to many of those antibiotics. And so a lot of people were getting poisoned, people who were susceptible, the same groups as today with the coronavirus. So typically elderly people, people with compromised immune systems were getting sick, and unfortunately the antibiotics weren't working. So we designed this cobalt MOF system, and here's the RRXX, so this is an octatopic. It has this kind of dumbbell shape over here, and if you look at a three-dimensional computer rendering of this, it will have a tetragonal space grouping format. And so the thought experiment is that you make your MOF composite and then introduce this into the environment or into the system that you're looking at, and that the idea is that these microbes that look like peanuts, these are basically rat-like microorganisms. They will interact on the outer surface of this porous tetragonal structure, And that the cobalt atoms with these ligands will introduce reactive lipid peroxidation on the outside. So basically, if you can't see this here, but this thing has an imaginary cellular membrane that is very rich in fats and lipids. And so what you end up doing is you oxidize those lipids, you basically increase the plasticity of these. And if you increase the plasticity of these membranes, you make them more fluid. Eventually you go to this area. They are so fluid that they go from a solid barrier to basically an oil-like barrier. And if you look at this, this microbe then basically dissolves itself. It basically undergoes dissolution. You can see this blubbing. And if you do EDX of these regions, you can then tell what type of heteroatoms you have. Typically, you're gonna have your carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, and phosphorus. And since DNA is very high in phosphorus, and proteins tend to have nitrogen and sulfur, then you could kind of discern where are those macromolecules in this cell. So again, this particular MOF doesn't get into the cell. We're not putting anything into the cell. We're just putting this environment where the cell interacts with the environment, and then you weaken this membrane, weaken it. So you do from a solid barrier to an oil-like barrier. And when you have oil-like barrier, then this thing will dissolve itself. And you will basically, like I shown here, die. And again, advantage of this is because this is a physical chemical oxidation process, it doesn't really matter whether this E. coli is immune to the antibiotic, because this is not an antibiotic process. So this is a general approach to purify pathogens in food and water that may or may not be immune. May or may not be tolerant to antibiotics. And that was the problem when in that nursing home was those patients, a lot of them were, the antibiotics weren't working because they had a developed immunity to that. So in this case, we are using a different approach, and therefore immunity doesn't really play into it. So this is a little bit more. So we can take these tetragonal domains and we can change them. And the idea is now, could we try the same idea but in a different way? Could we put something like dioxin in here, which is an anti-cancer drug? So instead of using this MOF to do some catalysis with the soft tissue, could we just merely have this MOF deliver a drug as a payload? So you deliver your payload into the environment and then release it based on some stimuli. And then you go from a healthy cell here to damaged cell. So now I think Dr. Ma mentioned this already, is called therapy diagnosis and therapy, or theragnostics. So the idea of theragnostics is that you visualize a pathological condition, you treat it, and then you again visualize that progression. And so that's one payload, one package that can do everything. So this is a nice way of getting clinical data at the same time as using these materials to deliver a particular drugs. And if you tailor these, as I showed you earlier, with making this 1-0-0 phase more polar, then you could conceivably have two different drugs, one on a coating on one face and another on the other face, and then you could then have this kind of bimodal distribution of drugs. So it's not a case of, you have to put everything in one basket. You could have multiple drugs released depending on how you engineer these surfaces. So the left diagram, I just put this back on just to give you guys an impression of what was done before. Then we looked at a different type of cancer cell. So cancer cells are where the cells are dividing when there's no need. So typically what happens is every cell in a body has a code. When the cell dies, the body replaces that cell by cell division. As you get older and older, the propensity to cell division decreases. And so your cells are not replaced as often. Cancer cells are where these cells are dividing and they're sucking up all the energy because cell division is very energy intensive. And that's a problem in that many of these cancer cells are difficult to treat. So we look at a different type of cancer cell known as A2780. And we basically took these metal organic frameworks, but instead of using cobalt, we use iron and zirconium. And the thinking here was that whenever you introduce a metal into a mammalian system, that the mammalian system doesn't use itself, that's going to induce toxicity. So if you, for example, put silicon into a cell, that's going to induce toxicity because our bodies are carbon-based, not silicon-based. So if you use iron, the idea is that intrinsic toxicity of the system is going to be lowered because many mammalian cells use iron or iron oxides for oxygen transport or some type of catalysis. And what we can see here is that when we make these MOFs, there's three different versions of that, but even at the ultra low dosage, which is in the high parts per billion, right, you can see that the cell viability is about the same, it's invariant. So it looks like that these MOFs are very effective even at very low dosage conditions. So let's have a look at the differences between 1, 2, and 3. Typically, the differences are the ligand, and in one case we have iron MOF, and in another case we have a zirconium MOF. C and D are your control, your healthy cell. You can see here, you can see some microvascularization here. So this cell is dividing, and you'll see light gray zones. And now what's going on is we're promoting cell death. So you can see here, and you can even see kind of some type of blubbing on the outer areas. So this cell will, in about 45 minutes, it will die. So what we've done is we changed the bond angle. And what we've used in this case are two different ligands. And so this particular ligand is called ATTA. We actually have another ligand called HTTA and PDDA. The names are not important. What is important is to understand that the bond angles are different. So the topography of this MOF system is slightly different. So we basically have spaced the propellers a little bit differently. And this is just showing you the variation across time. So actually the effectiveness of this is consistent. We're not overloading it. So typically what happens in a classical drug like aspirin, if you take aspirin, you'll notice a low value and then a peak, right? And then a drop because your liver is breaking the aspirin down. And so the dosage as function of time decreases as time goes on. In our case, that's not the case. In this case, it's almost like you have a insulin pump and you're pumping in insulin over time. And so the dosage of insulin is flat. And that's actually a good design because the side effects in our bodies are because we inject a drug into our bodies and we go from a 0% drug to 100% drug in a few seconds. And our bodies are not conditioned for that. So typically when you think about eating food or doing any type of thing, you gradually ramp up that molecule and then it slowly breaks down. So you want a constant dose. So here's an example here. Here's a TEM of control cell. These are neurons in your eye. These are retinal pigmented epithelial cells. And you could see here, after 4 hours, you can see some of these neurons, the plasma membrane of these neurons has been broken down. And so we can now use these different MOFs to treat nerve cells in a very precise way. So here, if these nerve cells are cancerous, we can go in and just remove the top layer of this and leave the bottom layer intact. So again, same idea, you guys can see this is architecture, this is 180 degree. You can see we're changing the angle of these propellers and you can see that the measurement across time is very consistent. We're not getting a spike, we're not getting a trough, we're just getting a horizontal line, meaning that the biochemistry and drug dosage is constant. So one of the things we wanted to look at was what happens when you deliberately stress the cell and how do you stop cell division? And so one of the things we wanted to play around was to confuse the cell, but changing the perception of time. As you guys know, the cells, they divide in 45 minutes. So we have an internal clock. Every cell has an internal clock that tells the cell when to divide. And in case of cancer, that clock is not aligned. And so we used a pretty standard assay called the lactate dehydrogenase assay. And what goes on here is lactate, that's the product of basically anaerobic respiration. So if you have low oxygen, you will make lactate. You convert that to PROVIT, which is an energy molecule. This is basically our redox probe. So we're moving in an electron or removing electron. And you see a color change. So this is just an assay. And what we wanted to compare was, we wanted to compare this with a drug called SN38. So SN38 is the standard anti-cancer drug that a lot of these doctors will prescribe. And so we have our neuron model. And the idea here is that you want your value to be lowest, the lower the dose, the better. So you can see SN38, you stress the cell with hydrogen peroxide, give it SN38 and measure it. And you can see that that's really where you want to be. Our iron system is near identical. So the top one is SN38 alone. The bottom one is SN38 and hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide is our oxidizing environment. In many cases, you can simulate this by using proton radiation. So a lot of people that do chemotherapy, you'll give them proton radiation and or chemical. So this is just kind of mimicking that environment. So you can see SN38 and then our drug, and then kind of proton therapy and SN38 a little bit better. This is the cells by themselves. And this is if you just give them hydrogen peroxide, you'll damage them. And the thing that I want to maybe just point out is that if you go from E, I'll talk about this in the next slide, but this D slide is interesting because you see this cell actually generating many of these microfibrils. So what is going on here is this is a cancer cell that wants to divide and make a duplicate. So he puts this probe out to start the initiation and then stops, then starts again, then stops, and then starts again, and then he stops. And so we're basically disrupting that internal clock. And so this cell is getting confused and does not know, should I divide or not divide? And so this is another way of soaking up the energy, right? And so the neighboring cells don't have that energy to divide, and you could slow the cancer down. So let's have a look at some of the other. So here, what we've shown is that at extremely low dosing, you can get basically the same phenomena as compared to traditional proton therapy. The other thing I'll mention is here's our normal cell. And so a lot of times there's a particular condition where your neurons overgrow and you get a kind of form of cataract. And so the idea is that you can go in and now remove the top layer of the dividing cells and get your underlying layer back. And so in many cases, the perception of sight can be restored, right? So you can do this not through surgery, but through selective chemotherapy, or in this case, MOF-based therapies. So a lot of these drugs that we use, or we talk about lithium-ion batteries. So what is going on with these lithium-ion batteries? And I just wanted to show you kind of a very basic biochemistry scheme here. So what typically happens in our cells is we have a machine in our cells called the mitochondria. And the mitochondria takes chemical energy, basically something like glucose, and converts that to electrical energy through a proton gradient. So we make protons, and then you see this plus minus. This is your chemical potential. You do that. what lithium would do, or sodium batteries or lithium batteries, is that lithium and sodium, they will interact with the cells and they will promote some type of reactive oxygen species generation. So here's just kind of a summary of those results. In the interest of time, I'm not going to show you those slides. But what you end up with is you generate singlet and triplet oxygen. And what the effect of singlet and triplet oxygen is the formation of a reactive center that promotes cell death through biochemical machinery known as caspase 3-7. So caspase is basically a messenger that tells the cell it's time to die. It's a family, there's a whole family of them. And so they have numbers after them, type 3, type 7. Okay, and so what we noticed was that when you have these lithium ion batteries or sodium ion batteries, that a lot of times these caspases are produced. And the second effect is when you produce a caspase, that this electrical potential is lowered and nitric oxide is released. And that's basically the beginning of your so-called death spiral. So then this cell will die. So right now we have over one battery per person, right? So if you think of how many people are in the world, each one has more than one battery. So there's typically millions of batteries that is disposed every day. And so I think one of the chief concerns as we go forward is when we make zinc air batteries or lithium or sodium batteries and we dispose of them, is what happens to the lithium or the sodium when it leaks out these ions? What happens when they leak out and go into the environment and do all this photochemistry? And then you ingest that, you drink that water and stuff like that. So one of the molecules that we make is nitric oxide. And nitric oxide is one of the molecules that won the Nobel Prize in medicine. It's a very important molecule. You know, but it does many things. So it's not a one molecule that's one thing. It does many things that control cell health. And nitric oxide is a very complicated molecule because it has a beneficial effect and it also has a deleterious effect depending on the concentration. And unfortunately, it's not a simple model. So low amounts of nitric oxide can be beneficial or harmful, and high amounts of nitric oxide can also be beneficial or harmful, depending on how and where they are made and how long they reside. But nitric oxide generally is generated from nitrite if you have low oxygen. And so, for example, if you have a stroke, if you have a heart attack, then this could be one way. The other way is directly from the amino acid arginine. So if you have a high amount of oxygen, so typically if you have a bacterial infection, your body will make nitric oxide from arginine, right? So you'll make NO two different ways. And the idea here is that you want to make NO as a form of defense against this pathogen. And so our bodies have different machines inside them to make this NO molecule. One method we looked at is xanthine oxidase. This cartoon is referring to NOS, N-O-S, and nitric oxide synthase. It's a machine that makes nitric oxide in our bodies. And we have this in our heart tissue, in our lung tissue, even in the mitochondria. And so typically the idea here is to lower the oxygen stress from superoxide or from some type of singlet oxygen. And so the idea is that you take this oxygen-containing molecules and make NO, and basically you scavenge the oxygen and lower the stress, because this O2 superoxide is, as you can imagine, oxidizing, very oxidizing, and it will promote caspase 3 release, and that will basically promote cell death. So I think we had a number of speakers earlier talk about Raman spectroscopy. And so we can follow this in cells. So if you take your cells and you give them lithium hydroxide or lithium lithiated nanoparticles from batteries, you'll see a shift in the Raman spectra. We could then put in MOFs with different metals. So the example I used was zirconium, cobalt, and here ferrous. And you can have different ligands. I showed you three different ligands. What you notice is that their absorption profile is a little bit different. Ours is here shown in the red. You can go to far infrared or a little bit to the left in the green. And what we notice is that not only is their absorption properties different, but if you change the dosage of the MOF to the ligand, you can basically change their absorption profile. So it's not even a case of different ligands. Even the stoichiometric ratio between the metal and the ligand, if you change that, you could change the optical properties of this. And so in our example, what we've shown is that these MOFs can introduce drugs into the system to kill those cells. We used A2870 type of system, CHO cells as well. And one of the things we noticed was that selective release of anti-cancer drugs or some type of hyperthermia will initiate caspase and LDH type of reaction, this so-called cytotoxicity. But that cytotoxicity is not due to the MOF. So that was a concern. Is our vehicle dangerous? Is the vehicle causing damage? The answer is no. The MOF itself is not toxic. It's the release of the MOF or how the ion in the MOF interacts with the cell and the magnetic field. The other thing we can do is to protect cells. As I mentioned earlier, if you have a stroke, you're going to have low oxygen. So could the MOF be used to release or store NO selectively and recycle it? So the idea is you have a stroke, NO is released to try to increase the oxygen balance, and then the extra NO that your cell doesn't need is stored so you don't make superoxide. And so that's one of the things that you talk to ER doctors, they'll talk about the magic minute. The idea is that if someone has a heart attack, you want to get oxygen into those tissues, you know, within 3 to 4 minutes at the onset. Otherwise, those muscles will be damaged. And in medicine, we use the word ischemia. So if you have an ischemic reaction, those muscles are damaged. And that's one reason why people have limited mobility after a stroke. Is mainly due to oxygen damage of those cells, those neurons. So one of the things we can do to minimize this ischemic damage is to design these materials that can have a very precise nitric oxide releasing profiles. So almost like a titration. So if you have 3% oxygen, which is low, you want to release a particular amount of NO to offset that. If you have a high amount of NO after, for example, a bacterial infection, that's dangerous. That's called sepsis, right? So you don't want to do that. So could we suck in the extra to avoid that? So you want this kind of bimodal distribution. As mentioned earlier in the last speaker, I talked about imaging. A lot of these cells are extremely hydrophobic because these are membranes, they're barriers. And so you want to be able to improve the hydrophobicity of your materials so they can cross that membrane that you do membrane insertion, but you don't want to damage the membrane. So you want them to go through the membrane without damaging the membrane. And so you want to keep the cellular integrity. If you want to do imaging, if you want to promote cell death, then you may want to weaken the membrane like we've shown with E. coli, and then undergo some type of exocytosis process. What we don't know is what is the effect of long-term lithium or sodium ion ingestion. So if people are drinking water that's contaminated with these energy materials, what is the effect? We know from Michigan Flint what the effects are of, say, chromium poisoning, right? And there is no biological reason to think that something similar in phenomena would not occur if people are drinking water that is contaminated with these energy materials long term. And so again, you can imagine that liver damage, neuron damage, memory loss would be more likely side effects of unattended release of these energy materials into the environment. So again, MOFs could be used, or these type of porous materials could be used that can release selectively NO or bind excess oxygen to minimize that biochemical damage. The other thing that we could think about is maybe mimicking the natural homonuclear or heteronuclear chemistry that goes on in our cells. In the previous cartoon, you looked at the energy production machinery, and the two metal ions in the energy production machinery that we have in E. coli are iron and copper. And so we can then try to link iron and copper using these sulfur centers. You can then kind of use your artificial system as a power station to take over the cell while the cell recovers. So a lot of times if you have disease, the mitochondria is not functioning to capacity. And one of the things that you'll notice is that in your cell, if the mitochondria is damaged and doesn't make ATP, the cell will then die. It will basically undergo apoptosis. And so you want that to happen in cancer cells, but not in healthy cells. So again, question, why do people have side effects when you do cancer treatment? Because you're killing healthy cells at the same time as cancer cells due to the manner in which chemotherapy is delivered. It's a broad basket effect. It's not cell by cell. So idea here is you can use your porous materials to mimic a catalysis that undergoes in the mitochondria. You can be using these iron copper binding sites, and you then allow the cell to maintain the energy balance. The cancer cell died, but the healthy cell then recovers. That's a possibility. Right now, both would die. I think Dr. Ma talked about activation using visible light. And so that's another area that we can do this. We've done this with magnetic fields, with iron. Could you activate that system using visible light? And then the idea is that the visible light system then can quench the radical oxygens and minimize oxidative damage in the cells. And so one of the molecules that is particularly damaging within the cells after a stroke is singlet oxygen. So you notice this SOS, it's actually a very, very toxic material, even though its half-life is a few milliseconds, it's very toxic. And so if you could quench the SOS signal in healthy cells, but promote its generation in solid tumor cells, then you basically have a scalpel that is gonna only damage the solid tumor cells. And what we've done with these iron zirconium systems is promote SOS in the ovarian cells, but not in the neurons. And what we notice is the ovarian tumor mass decreases, but the neuron basically stays the same. I mean, the cytotoxicity profile, the LDH profile of the neurons is the same before and after. So again, you want to use these drugs or these materials as scalpels, whereas today I think we use them as bludgeons. We use proton therapy like a hammer, right? We hit everything. That idea is that the cancer cell dies, but the surrounding area also unfortunately gets done. So you want a more like a bludgeon for soft tissues where it's very cancerous, but pancreatic cancer, you really want a scalpel, and you want to go a few cells at a time if possible. I want to thank our funding agencies and some of the work from the Air Force, Texas A&M, the Welch Foundation, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have.